It is a wonderful thing to be involved in the quest to win souls and bring them to Christ. It's not something that we do so that we can brag about how many of you led to the Lord, how many of I. That's not the point. That's self-focused. That's pride-based. But we ought to seek to be someone that God wants to use and can use and does use to plant seeds and to water seeds. It's been said that if you can help to bring a sinner, a lost sinner, one step closer to Christ, you can be joyful about that. That's what our job is, one step at a time and be used by God. And that's what we see here in Luke chapter 10. Let's read the first 16 verses. Luke chapter 10, verse 1. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also and sent them two by two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. Carry neither purse, nor scrip, nor shoes, and salute no man by the way. And into whatsoever house ye enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall turn to you again. And in the same house remain, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his hire. Go not from house to house. And into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you, and heal the sick that are therein. And say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. But into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you not, go your ways out into the streets of the same, and say, even the very dust of your city, which cleaveth on us, we do wipe off against you. Notwithstanding, be ye sure of this, that the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable in that day than for Sodom, than for that city. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works had been done in Tyre and Sidon, which have been done in you, they had a great while ago repented, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted to heaven, shalt be thrust down to hell. He that heareth you heareth me, and he that despiseth you despiseth me, and he that despiseth me despiseth him that sent me. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful for the record that we have in the scriptures of what Jesus did and said and the people that he sent and the instruction that he gave. I pray that you would help us to learn from this instruction, to learn what we should and no more, no less. And I pray that you would speak to us, help us to pattern our lives as much as we ought according to what we see here and elsewhere in the scriptures. Lord, I pray that you would give us a burden for souls. Help us to have a desire to carry the message that has transformed our lives and to carry it to others who still need to be transformed and converted. Pray that you would speak to us tonight. Work in our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. We talk a lot about fulfilling the Great Commission, and you've heard this preached many times. Many years you've talked about it, you've desired to do it, and it would be a fair question to ask, how do I do this? How do I accomplish this? The Great Commission, how do I do it today, in 2024, in your life, whatever your life is, in your phase of life, stage of life, in the opportunities that you have, how do we fulfill the Great Commission? Do we do it through witnessing? What about tracts? What role do they play in fulfilling the Great Commission? What about prayer? What about faith promise missions giving? What role does that have to play in the Great Commission? What about preaching? And I'm preaching right now. You can be a preacher one-on-one even to somebody who needs the truth. What about social media? What role does that play in fulfilling the Great Commission? And we could go on and on. What about this? What about that method? What about this form, area of life? What role does that play in fulfilling the Great Commission? And how do we know if we're fulfilling it? there's not a ding, you just did it, good job, and we don't get a confirmation or affirmation in that way necessarily. How do we know? As long as we're sincere and we're doing our best and trying hard, is that what the Lord expects? Is the Lord pleased with us? Are we fulfilling the Great Commission as long as we try? Scripture, of course, gives us many principles and examples to follow. When we look in the Gospels and in Acts and beyond, we see many examples of fulfilling the Great Commission. And in our text tonight, we see many principles and truths to consider and things that we can put into practice. Tonight, I'd like us to ponder the fulfillment of the Great Commission. And we see in verse 1 that the Lord sent out 70, but before he did that, he sent out the 12. Look at Luke chapter 9, verse 1, and we see the Lord sending out the 12. In a very similar fashion, we have several similarities. It's not as long of a text. He's not as explicit that the Bible records in his instruction. But the overall goal and the point and the purpose is the same. Luke chapter 9, verse 1. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And he said unto them, take nothing for your journey, neither staves nor scrip, neither bread, neither money, neither have two coats apiece. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide, and thence depart. And whosoever will not receive you when ye go out of that city, shake off the very dust of your feet for a testimony against them. And they departed and went through the towns, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. It's a shorter passage, but it's the same basic idea here. A lot of similarities. And I want us to go back to Luke chapter 10 and see 10 things in this text, in this chapter, 10 things that pertain to the fulfillment of the Great Commission and 10 things that we can apply to our lives. There are some things that don't apply to us, but there are some things that do. First of all, I want us to see that the fulfillment of the Great Commission is guided by the Lord. Look at verse 1. The Lord appointed other 70 also, and the Lord sent them 2 by 2 before his face into every city and place, whither he himself would come. The Lord had a plan. He sent, he chose, he sent, he appointed. That's choosing. He sent them before his face. I'm planning to be there. I'm planning to visit there. I want you to go before me. And he had it all planned and guided. He told them where they ought to be. This is an important mission. If the Lord is guiding this, we know that it's important. God is not involved and occupied with frivolous things. You and I can be involved and occupied with frivolous endeavors, frivolous pursuits. And that is a terrible way to spend our life. We could all say, yeah, I've wasted time. And that is a tragedy. We should not waste time. Our physical life is a limited time. It's finite. And when we waste it, we are just draining away a great resource that God has given us. God doesn't waste time. He's not occupied with frivolous pursuits. And when he appoints and when he sends, it's important. It is guided by the Lord. Look at verse 2. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. This is why you're being appointed and sent. Pray ye, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. And I think we don't need to look any further than Grand Forks to know that the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. No doubt there are more people that live in Grand Forks that are saved than just would come to a church like ours. But there are many more lost people than there are saved people. I think we can say that quite safely. And you go to a city like, even Minneapolis and St. Paul or New York, Chicago, L.A. I mean, you could, all around the world, there are big cities, millions of people, and only a very tiny fraction of them are saved. And then the rural areas, thousands of people scattered around, the state of North Dakota where there isn't a gospel witness. And who's going to reach them? The harvest is great, but the laborers are few, and we ought to pray that God would send forth laborers, but not just pray that God would send forth other people, but pray that he would send forth us. Lord, send me to wherever you want me to go. I don't know where that is. Maybe it's next door. Maybe it's across the world. Maybe it's into the next state. But Lord, send somebody. Let the harvest affect our heart. It's guided by the Lord, and that is important. The Great Commission, the fulfillment of the Great Commission, needs to be guided by the Lord. It's not enough. It's not enough for us to just go out and work and do it in our own efforts. It's important. I would be pleased if I heard that you went out and were handing out tracts. You were telling people about the Lord. That's wonderful. We ought to be doing that. But if it's just in our own wisdom, just in our own strength, the reward and the return for that is going to be very limited. If we're sharing the word of God, it will not return void. But how much better for the Lord to appoint you and send you to where he wants you to be. Then you know that he's prepared a time and a place for you to be laboring. He's prepared a place in the harvest for you to be busy. It's a wonderful thing. We were talking about this last night. I mentioned this in church this morning. Divine appointments and how there were a few things that happened. Brother Brazy told me about another one of those. Crossing paths with somebody. Is this just coincidence? I don't think so. But when the Lord does that, it's guided by him. We see him work, and it goes far beyond anything we could do in our own energy and our own strength. It's an important mission, and the fulfillment of the Great Commission needs to be and is guided by the Lord. We just need to be submitted to that. The Lord sent them. He said, when you go, this is what I want you to do. For this purpose, the harvest is great, and the laborers are few. And so you get busy. You go out there. You go in the direction I'm sending you. He ought to guide us as well. If we're going to be fulfilling the Great Commission, we need to do it being guided by the Lord. But we see in verse 3 something else. He says, go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. And you sit and think about that, and that sounds kind of frightening. I don't think a lamb, you know, we think of a flock of sheep and one wolf causing great damage in a flock. What about a lamb into a pack of wolves? How long would that lamb last? Not very long. And so we would say this is a frightening thing. This is an intimidating thing. And the world is not favorable to the gospel. But not only is the fulfillment of the Great Commission guided by the Lord, it's preserved by the Lord. If the devil had his way, he would defeat all of us. But he doesn't have his way. We are protected. Lambs among wolves, we are not there for conquest. We are not there to destroy and defeat and conquer in that sense. We're there going into the lair of the enemy, so to speak. The devil is there to oppose us, but it is protected by the Lord. And so you and I can go fearlessly. You know what? I'm not comfortable knocking on a stranger's door and talking to them about their soul. That's not something that's comfortable to my flesh. Probably not to yours either. I'm not comfortable going up to a group of people. I'm not a very big person, as you can tell. And sometimes I talk to people who are much bigger than me and seem like they would want to make fun of me or maybe even physically oppose me. It doesn't make me feel comfortable to go into that kind of situation. There are places where missionaries that we support in other continents are very dangerous places. I was reading a prayer letter by Brother Abdu Issa, and he was talking about the terrible crime and how dangerous it is in Lebanon. I wouldn't wish for that for myself, and I'm sure they're not comfortable in that kind of situation. But he talked about how they're protected. God's protecting them. The fulfillment of the Great Commission is protected by the Lord, and I'm thankful for that. These lambs among wolves, they came back, and we read this later. They returned with joy because they were protected. You and I are protected, and so we can be bold. Yes, we're lambs among wolves, but you know what? We can be as bold as if we're wolves among lambs. What does a wolf have to fear from a lamb? Nothing. What do we have to fear from the devil? Absolutely nothing, because we're protected by the Lord. We don't have to fear anything from sinners. Only God will only allow what is good for us, so we don't have to be afraid. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7 says, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. And this illustrates to us that when God ordains, when God protects, when God works, when God puts his hand on something, no man is going to overturn that. God's going to protect you. God's going to protect me. God's going to prepare hearts. And so we just need to seek to be used by God, seek to go to the places that he has for us. I'm thankful for God's preservation. The gospel is not a popular message. And these first two points are the most important ones. The fulfillment of the Great Commission is guided by the Lord. Does he guide you? Does he guide me? Or do we just do it in our own strength? We ought to do it by his direction. It's guided by the Lord and it's preserved by the Lord. And so we ought to pray that he would do that for us. It is his mission, after all. And it's guided by his wisdom. And it's preserved by his power, not ours. And so we should remember that. And if we remember that it's his mission, it's his harvest, and it's guided by his wisdom, and it's preserved and kept by his power, it will keep us humble. It will keep us prayerful, and it will keep us secure. So let's just get busy. Let's do it. Let's go. Let's be out there in the harvest. Let's be guided when we have these things, when we know it's guided and preserved by the Lord. But there's more to it as well. Number four, look at verse four. Carry neither purse nor scrip nor shoes, and salute no man by the way. Our life, if you're a child of God, your life should be defined and should be characterized by daily, regular fulfillment of the Great Commission. There are many ways to preach the gospel and many ways to witness to souls and shine the light in darkened hearts. Many ways to do that. We ought to be busy about it all the time, every day. You think about a laborer working for a farmer, and when it's harvest time, they don't get time off. They don't. You've got to pull in the harvest. It's there. It's going to be ruined. We need to be busy. And we physically, and we get days off work and that sort of thing. But we shouldn't have any days off from serving the Lord. We don't have any me days and then days for the Lord. You know, this is a me day, Lord. I can do whatever my flesh wants. We understand that's not how it works. We ought to be characterized by our busyness in this Great Commission. And in verse 4 here, he talks about, Don't provide for yourself. Carry neither purse nor scrip nor shoes. When he sent out the 12, he said, don't take any money. Don't provide for yourself. Don't try to think ahead to your needs and take care of your own needs. Don't focus on that. Salute no man by the way. The fulfillment of the Great Commission, it is a mission of faith and focus. I'm trusting God to take care of me, and I'm focused on what I ought to do. He says, salute no man in the way. And this salute is not, you know, the military salute. It's not even saying hi. There were these customs in Eastern cultures, these customs of greeting each other and chatting, speaking to each other, catching up and all of these things. And it could take quite a while. You're traveling this road and you see somebody coming. We're going to salute you now. And it might be quite a long time before you're done with that custom. All of these different rituals and things that they would do, it's not our culture, but it would be part of theirs. And the Lord is saying, don't get distracted. Don't spend time doing that. Be focused on your mission. You are here to go from town to town to preach the gospel. Don't use up your time with these cultural, customary things. Be focused. What kinds of things can we spend our life doing? That's not really fulfilling the Great Commission. Well, we can make a case, you know, for pursuing this thing. Okay, that might have some temporal value, but is it really fulfilling the Great Commission? When you get to heaven, are you going to be glad that you spent time doing that? Well, you know, I want to be friendly, and so I'm going to salute. Well, what did the Lord say? And of course, I'm not saying, and I don't think the Lord was saying, don't say hi to anyone, okay? Just ignore everybody. Of course, I don't think that was his point. We ought to be friendly. We ought to reach out to people. But how are we spending our time? Are we doing it in empty things? Spending our time in empty things. Look at John chapter 21. Are we focused? Are we trusting the Lord? Don't worry about your future and who's going to provide for you. The Lord's going to provide for you. Trust him. Fulfilling the Great Commission is letting him take care of your physical needs so that you can focus on the harvest. And that's what Matthew chapter 6 is all about. The latter half, the latter part of Matthew chapter 6. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. This is the idea. And we see in John 21:15, this focus as well. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And there's been some discussion about what he's talking about. Do you love me more than these other disciples love me? Do you love me more than these fish? Love me more than you love fishing? I think, I personally think it's more the latter. What do you love more? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. Focus on the job that I have for you. He saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thine hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. Then Peter, turning about, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved following, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, and what shall this man do? Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. It's easy to get distracted, to be focused on others, other things, other people. And Jesus is saying, don't worry about what's going to happen to him. You focus on the job that I've given you. Feed my sheep. Maybe I'll tell you what's going to come for you. And he did. This is the death you're going to die. But you focus on your job. Am I focusing on my job? Are you focusing on yours? Fulfilling the Great Commission, it's a mission of faith and focus. Hebrews 12:1-2 says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Lay aside the weight, lay aside the sin, and look unto Jesus. Focus on him. Don't let these things weigh you down. It's so easy to say, oh, that thing looks nice. That temporal possession looks nice. That way to spend my time, that practice, that engagement, that sort of activity, that looks fun. Let's try that. That would be enjoyable, but it's a weight, and it takes our attention away from what we should be engaged in. It's so easy to gather things to ourselves, and suddenly they demand our time, and we don't have time to serve the Lord. We don't have time to witness. These are weights. They may not be sinful, but they're weights, and they sap our energy and sap our thoughts, and they sap our time. Are we focused on the job the Lord's given us to do? And that looks a little bit different for everybody. You know, one thing that might be wrong for you might not be wrong for me, and vice versa. But we need to ask ourselves, am I trusting the Lord, or am I trying to provide for my needs? The Lord said, when you go out, don't carry money, don't carry a bag, don't carry two coats, he said to his 12 disciples. Just one is enough. Well, Lord, what if it wears out? I'll take care of you. I'll figure out what you need for your, well, I'll figure out how to provide for your needs. You focus on the job I've given you. Faith, trust the Lord, and focus on the job he's given. Let's look back at Luke chapter 10. Fulfilling the Great Commission. How should our lives be characterized? With what things? Well, peace. Luke chapter 10, verse 5, and into whatsoever house ye enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall turn to you again. I'm not saying that we need to say this every time we enter a house, But we, our ministry should be one of peace. Our life should be characterized by peace, not necessarily physical peace. If you lived in Ukraine right now, your physical life would not be characterized by peace. If you lived in Israel, you would not be characterized by peace. But inner peace, do you have inner peace? It's amazing how often we can squander our inner peace. We can set our mind on distressing things, and we can fail to trust the Lord, and we can dabble over here in these things that are unresolvable, and we just get ourselves all stirred up, and we get frustrated and angry or whatever, and we lose our peace. The life of the gospel witness should be characterized by peace because we're preaching the gospel of peace. Why would people want what we have if we're not even at peace? You really need to listen to what I have to say. It's the gospel of peace. Well, I don't see peace in your life. How do I know it works? Our lives should be characterized by peace. Jesus said in John 14:26, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." And these 70 disciples were commanded to bring peace to the house in which they stayed. We're here in this town. We're here to preach. Peace be to this house. You're going to be these hosts, families, whoever opened their doors to these preachers, they were going to be rewarded with peace while these disciples were here. And people should sense peace in your life. You witness to them, they should know that you have the peace of God on your life. They should not see distress and worry and fear. We deal with those things. Yes, we do, because we're still sinners. We're still fallible and limited, but we shouldn't be characterized by that. We shouldn't let those things affect and dominate our life. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." When we have peace with God, that should just calm and wash over and submerge any other kind of turmoil we might have. You know what? There are parts of my life that I wish were more peaceful. But when I know the peace of God, I can live in that. That's bigger than any other turmoil I might have. Romans 10:15 says, "And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." When others look at your life, do they see peace? Or do they see turmoil and frantic behavior, worried behavior? Peace. Romans 15:13 says, "Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost." You know, if it's really a mission of faith for us, if we're really trusting the Lord, we're going to have peace. But what if they don't get saved? Well, leave that with the Lord. But what if this doesn't happen? Leave it with the Lord. So often we try to help God out. You know, God's not doing this thing, so I need to get involved. I need to take control. I need to start making this happen because he's not doing his job, doesn't see what's going on, doesn't see what's needed, and then we don't have peace. When we live in faith, we do have peace. Let's rest in that, and let's preach it. Let's show it. That's what other people need too. More than you need. If you're saved, they need peace more than you do because you have peace with God. Something they don't have. Look at Luke 10, verse 7. It says, "And in the same house remain, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his hire. Go not from house to house." And he's talking about being provided for, allowing yourself to be cared for. And this is a great thing. This is a form of charity, a form of caring for others that we don't see in our culture. You know, it's a sad truth, I think, that when charity and caring for those in need becomes public and forced, it becomes less voluntary and less purposeful. If people are going to take from my taxes and pay for them, I feel personally less emotionally involved to help them because I'm already paying. This is the sort of result that it has in our heart. But if nobody's going to meet their need unless I get involved, and if I know them, they live down my street and they need help, I'm going to go take it on me to help them. And this is what offerings do. We give money to help meet the needs of missionaries and so on. We do that voluntarily. Maybe you have charities in the public sector that you give to voluntarily because you feel that they perform an important function, important need. But this verse 7 is talking about people who say, yeah, I'll show you hospitality. Come in. You can stay with us. You're here preaching the message. We think it's a good thing. Stay with us. We'll feed you. We'll take care of you. And Jesus says, whoever lets you into their house, just take what they give you. For the laborer is worthy of his hire. Go not from house to house. Don't go around asking for handouts. Don't try to get more. And here I see it is a mission of temperance. Be under control. Be content with what they give you. Be temperate. Be satisfied. 1 Corinthians 9:27 says, Paul writes, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. As we live our lives serving the Lord, preaching the gospel, we need to live temperate lives. We can get out of control sometimes. We can have appetites that run away with us, and we start to pursue other things to feed those appetites because we love it. And it might be lawful. It might not be condemned by the scriptures, but we're not temperate. Leisure time is one of those things that we can seek after and spend too much time doing. I was joking. We had a practice yesterday. I was joking with a couple of fathers, and I was talking about how I've thought back to my early married days before we had any children, and I think, what did we do with all our time? We had so much time compared to now. I don't even know how we spent it. We thought we were busy, but we weren't busy compared to what we are now. And when we have that time, we can spend it in intemperate ways. Also, when you're really busy and then you have some spare time, it can result in an overreaction to use that for yourself. I finally have some spare minutes. They're all mine. And that can be a selfish attitude too. What does the Lord want us to do? Temperance. Jesus said, when you go to these places and you eat and drink, just take what they give you and be happy with that. Go not from house to house. Be under control. And related to that, verse 8, it says, into whatsoever city ye enter and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Again, these are instructions given for these disciples as they go out preaching the gospel. Your job is to go into the harvest, and this is how I want you to behave. We don't live this way. We don't travel two by two to cities and stay there and then move on. So it might be hard to kind of fit these things into our life. But I think it's notable that the Lord says, you're going to go out. I've got a mission for you. You're going to go travel. You're going to go preach. And while you're out there living and doing that, I want you to behave this way. These are the priorities I want you to have. This is how I want you to think. This is how I want you to behave. And into whatsoever city you enter and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Well, I don't like that. They serve me liver and onions, Lord. Eat what's set before you. Gratitude and contentment. Be thankful for what you have. Be thankful for what you're given. And again, we don't live in somebody else's house while we're preaching and do these things. But what has the Lord given you? Well, I don't, you know, the stage of life I'm in, I've got this and I've got that and I have to do this and I don't like that. We ought to be thankful. We ought to be contented. Paul writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Amazon helps us to be discontented. Radio advertisements, TV advertisements, billboards, stores, they all contribute to us not being content with what we have. And it's not wrong to buy things. You understand this. But it's so easy to just want that next thing and to not be content, to be focused on accumulating things. We ought to be thankful for what the Lord's given us and content with what He's given us. How can we be grateful and content? Well, primarily because we have a wonderful home waiting for us for all eternity. And whatever we accumulate in this life, can't take with us. So how much better would it be to use those resources, not the ones we would spend on essential things, but on non-essential things. Do I really need to add this to my life? Or can I be content without it? Do I really need to spend my time or money doing this thing? You know, I've got a spare hour. How should I spend it? On me or on the Lord so I can be more like Him? Oh, I really enjoy this thing. I understand. So do I. And there's a time and place for some of those things, to enjoy the blessings from the Lord. But what is our focus? Are we content? We should be grateful and content. Thinking about where we're going to be one day should help us to be grateful for whatever we have here and content as we preach to others. Jesus said in John 14, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." I don't know about you, but I find it a lot easier to be content and to not covet what others might have. When I remember, that's fine, they've got that, that'd be nice, but you know what, I've got something a lot better waiting for me. I'll have something much better than this later. I'll just wait for it. I don't need to seek after that thing. I can be content. We ought to be grateful. And when we live this way, other people are going to notice. And they're going to say, "There's something you have that really works. Would you tell me about that?" Because so many people are caught up in pursuing things or pursuing relationships or pursuing entertainment, and you don't seem to live that way. You seem to be content with what you have. What makes you that way? Well, let me tell you. I've got a home in heaven, and this is how you can too. Look at verse 9, Luke 10, verse 9. "And heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you." Two things. You're in this home, and they're feeding you, they're providing for you, they're sheltering you. While you're there, heal the sick that are there. The people that have need, they're sick, heal them, but also make it clear that the kingdom of God is come nigh unto them. It's not about just their sickness. It's about the fact that the kingdom of God is in you, and it's nigh unto them. And here I see that it's a mission of ministry. What do people need from you? Well, primarily they need the truth of God's word. But people need other things than just that. Do they need a friend? Do they need time spent with them? Do they need physical help? You know, they can't lift that. They can't go over there. You can give them a ride. They need someone who cares. They need to know that you love them. They need to be ministered unto. The Great Commission is a mission of ministry. In Matthew 10:5, it says, "Jesus sent the 12 and commanded them, saying, Go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, The kingdom of God of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give." There are many other things that people need besides the gospel. The gospel is the most important part. That's what we ought to be preaching. But there are going to be times when people need you to minister to their physical needs. Are we doing that? Well, I'm only going to... Well, that's not the right attitude. That's the most important thing. And we ought to be looking primarily for a chance to minister to their spiritual needs, to give them the gospel. But we ought to be willing to minister to their physical needs as well. That takes time. I heard the video call this morning with Brother Morrison and Eswatini. It went really well. And I appreciate Brother Sikorski, I think, primarily was responsible for setting that up. And I know Brother Gabe helped technology-wise to get that set up. But But I heard about the, what do they call it, the Diligence Academy. And it's things that the men in that church, the African men in that church in Baban, started on their own, and they created a soccer league. There are all these soccer teams in town. They play soccer, and they organized it for these teams to play each other. And on Saturdays, they have them meet, and they teach them truth from God's word, and they preach to them, and they show them how to be a man, and they teach them these things, and they play soccer too, and they coach them. And it's just a way to invest in lives. They're meeting other needs besides just the gospel need. They're showing them that these men care. They're showing them that people care for their bodies and their souls and their lives, and they're affecting lives, and that's how we ought to live as well. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul writes to the church in Corinth, and he's talking about the offering taken up for the saints in Jerusalem. And he talks about, in verse 10, he says, "Herein I give my advice, for this is expedient for you who have begun before, not only to do, but also to be forward a year ago. Now therefore, perform the doing of it, that as there was a readiness to will, so there may be a performance also out of that which ye have. For if there first be a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man hath, and not according to that he hath not." If you're willing to give to this, you'll be able to. "For I mean not that other men be eased and ye burdened." This isn't about putting a burden on you so that they can have it easy. This is about meeting needs out of your abundance. He says, "But by an equality, that now at this time your abundance may be a supply for their want, and that their abundance also may be a supply for your want, that there may be equality. As it is written, he that had gathered much had nothing over, and he that had gathered little had no lack." What's he talking about? Well, he's referring back to Exodus, where God sent manna. And when the manna came down in the camp of Israel, the ones who were heads of their household, head over those in their tent, they were to gather and make sure that everybody who lived in their tent had enough manna to eat that day. They were responsible to gather up so that if there were some that were sick and couldn't gather or unable to do it for themselves, that they were still provided for. And Paul is referring to this principle. You might have extra money. Use that for those who don't have enough. And it's a wonderful way to view the resources that God has given us. In our Western culture, we can tend to think about storing up enough for ourselves to provide for our future, and then we can start to think about helping others. Once I have my retirement provided for, then I can give. Well, people live and work their whole lives and still don't have enough for retirement. But if you have a little extra right now and somebody else needs something right now, it's a wonderful perspective to say, "I've got an abundance right now. I could give to that. But what then? What about me?" Well, the Lord can take care of you. And Paul says later, when they have an abundance, they can meet your need. It's a great way to spend the resources that God has given us, because the Lord might come back tomorrow and all these things that I've piled up for myself are going to be left behind anyway. Giving our abundance to minister to however people might need it. "I've got some spare time. I'll help people who don't have enough time in their day to get their things done. I've got some extra money. I'll use it for those who don't have enough money. I've got an extra tool or an extra set of clothing, whatever they might need. I'll give to that, and the Lord can provide for my needs." A mission of ministry. Look at verse 10 of Luke 10. But into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you not, go your ways out into the streets of the same, and say, even the very dust of your city, which cleaveth on us, we do wipe off against you. Notwithstanding, be ye sure of this, that the kingdom of God has come nigh unto you. Again, the same phrase that's used back in verse 9, when healing the sick. People rejected the message, and they were told to make it clear, you're rejecting this, and you have that ability, you have that prerogative, but you need to know that the kingdom of God is still come nigh unto you. You need to know what you're rejecting here. Verse 12, "But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable in that day for Sodom than for that city." And we could go on. We read these verses already. It's more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon than for Bethsaida and Chorazin. Cities of Israel are going to be held more accountable than these wicked, wicked cities of Tyre and Sidon and Sodom. It's a mission of consequence. This is an important thing. And how we fulfill this mission and how people respond to this message carries great consequence. Luke 12:48 says, "For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more." You know, the longer I live and the more that I work at becoming a better witness and trying to be more led by the Spirit and filled with the Spirit in what I say and do, the more urgency I have to make clear to people what I'm trying to say. If I'm cautious, if I'm not bold, if I'm timid, I might be trying to work my way around in the conversation to finally invite them to church. And we talk for 5 minutes and I didn't really get anywhere, and then that's the end of it. I missed my, what did I really say to them? What do they know about Christ as a result of this conversation? Maybe nothing, because I was timid. But I want them to know I'm going to take more advantage of my time. Are you saved? Do you know where you're going when you die? I want to make it clear. This is what I'm preaching. This is the kingdom of heaven here. I'm preaching the gospel. I want you to know, because this is consequential. If I fail in my job to give you the gospel, that carries consequences. I'm going to be ashamed one day when I had an opportunity and I didn't preach it. But on the other side, if I preach the gospel to you and you reject it, that has consequences too. This mission is consequential, and we know this. These are all familiar truths to us, but sometimes we can forget it. Jesus said, when you go to these places and they reject you, that is no small matter. Wipe off the dust of your feet. Let them know that rejection is on their own head, because you're preaching the gospel of the kingdom and they say no. But sometimes I think that we want to preach the gospel of the kingdom. We want to witness. We're trying to, but we don't actually do that. Maybe we just said, hey, you should come to church sometime. What did they know of Christ that they didn't know before? It's good to invite people to church, but that's not the same thing as giving them the gospel. If people have to come to church to hear the gospel, people aren't being a witness. I'm not being a witness if I don't witness out there and I just expect them to come here in order to hear the gospel. It's our job to go and preach. It is a mission of consequence. I am responsible for giving the gospel, and if I don't, that carries consequences. They are responsible for accepting the gospel, and there are consequences if they don't. It's a sobering thing. Verse 16 says, "He that heareth you, heareth me, and he that despiseth you, despiseth me, and he that despiseth me, despiseth him that sent me." These are consequences, but I also see representation here. It is a mission of representation. He that hears us, they're listening to Christ. That's an amazing thing. You and I can be representatives of the only begotten Son of God. And that should cause us to be careful in how we live. We are ambassadors of the King of Kings. Jesus said in Matthew 28:19, "Go ye, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost." We are representatives of the King. It's a mission of representation. And again, it should make us be sober-minded about this. And I think that we are. But it's good for us to be reminded and to see that these principles are not just philosophical. They're right here in the text. "He that heareth you, heareth me," the Lord said. I am authorizing you. This is my message that you're preaching. You are on my behalf here going out and doing that. And however they respond reflects upon me and how they would respond to me. 1 Peter 2:9 says, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." What kind of representative are we? We're an ambassador of the King, and we should live that way. We should talk that way. we should go as the king would have us go. Go to the places that the Lord himself would go, fearlessly. He's guiding us. He's protecting us. It's a message of peace and all these other things. It's a consequential thing. We're representing him. And I don't know about you, but when I think about the fact that this is not my message. This is a message that the Lord has entrusted to me. And I don't understand why he would. Because if I were in his shoes, I wouldn't entrust it to me. I'd do it myself. But the Lord has given us this message. And we can be his representative. We can be his ambassador. And he'll help us. He'll do it for us. We have to be available and submitted. It's a wonderful thing that we can be engaged in. Lastly, and we haven't read these verses yet, the Great Commission is a mission of joy. Verse 17, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. They didn't return saying, well, Lord, we tried. There were only a couple of people that listened to us. Sometimes we can have that attitude. I've been blessed in recent years by focusing on what I believe are closer to the right things that I should be focused on, such as, was I able to talk to that person about spiritual things? Did we actually have a conversation about it? That's a lot easier to accomplish than, did that person pray to be saved? Or did that person say they'd come to church? Or did that person ask me more questions, all the questions that I wish they would ask? We can look for these results and feel discouraged because people didn't come to church. But instead, we should be saying, was I able to plant a seed there? Was I able to get them to think? Was I able to speak the word of God to them? Could I quote scripture, the supernatural, quick and powerful word of God? Was I able to do that? That's a blessing. I ought to be encouraged about that. I ought to be joyful about that. I was engaged and involved in this. But these 70 returned saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Lord, we were able to do things that are far beyond our ability to do because of your power. And it's a joyful thing. Verse 18, and he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Wow, that's impressive. And the Lord hasn't done that for us. But you know what? That's not the most important thing. Verse 20, notwithstanding, in this rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. If we can't give the gospel in joy simply because it applies to me and my name's in heaven, we need to have our thoughts changed. We need to have our heart changed. It is a mission of joy. Can I tell you about what the Lord did for me? Whether you say no or not, whether you want it or not, that's up to you. But I am joyful that I can tell you my name is written in heaven. Let me tell you what God did for me and what he continues to do for me. You know, if you have a daily walk with God, you should always have something new to talk about, a blessing from the Lord, an answered prayer. Yesterday, the Lord answered a prayer of mine, and I really needed him to. I said, Lord, I know what I'm dealing with here. I need you. And he came. He answered. He gave me what I needed. He delivered me. Praise the Lord. That should be a regular thing for us. And it is a joyful thing to say, my name is written in heaven. I don't know when I'm going to get there. I don't know when this life is going to end. I don't know what that book of life looks like, the Lamb's book of life. I just know my name's there. So can I tell you about it? Do you know your name is there? Do you know for sure if you were saved? If you died today, are you saved? Or are you lost? Would you go to heaven? It is a mission of joy. And I understand sometimes we can get discouraged because nobody seems to listen to us. But in my experience, I think the reason that I feel that way is more about me than about them. Nobody will listen to me. Well, I think it's more about my fault than theirs. The Lord's not guiding me because I'm not submitting myself. The Lord's not empowering me because I'm not picking up my cross and following him. The Lord's not crossing my path with that person who's seeking because I didn't ask him to. It's more my fault than it is the people I'm trying to talk to. The Lord hasn't changed. The harvest hasn't gone anywhere. It's still out there. And I believe the laborers are still few. God doesn't ask us to go and labor in the harvest to not bring in any harvest. He doesn't say, go out and work in the fields and, you know, I'm sending you to a part of the field that's already been harvested. There's no more to harvest. Nothing's going to happen. Just go out there and occupy yourself. No, that's not what he's doing. He wants to send you to somebody who's seeking so that they can get saved. And same for me. And so we can go with joy. We need to be submitted. We need to be guided. We need to be protected. And we need to be grateful and contented and temperate and all of these things. But the Lord wants people to be saved because of you. That's a joyful thing. It is a mission of joy. I think about what the Lord said in John chapter 7, verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. What is your experience, your relationship with the Spirit of God? Is it a daily thing or is it more theoretical? If you walk with the Lord every day, it's not hard for you to say, I'm so glad I have the Spirit of God. I'm so glad he's there for me. If you've got an hour, let me tell you what he's done for me. It's a joyful thing. It's not forced. It's not theoretical. It's a mission and a message of joy. Also, because of what Revelation tells us. Turn there and we'll finish. Revelation chapter 21. Is your name written in heaven? Then you can be joyful for that fact alone. Revelation 21:10. And he carried me away in the Spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. And it goes on, let's skip down to verse 18. And the building of the wall was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation with jasper, the second sapphire, the third a chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth a topaz, the tenth a chrysoprasus, the 11th a jacinth, the 12th an amethyst. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Rejoice in this. This is where you're going to end up. We can be joyful. We can tell others about this joy. We can desire it for them. This is a great mission that we have. The fulfillment of the Great Commission is no small thing. We know this. It carries great consequence. And there's a great destination waiting for us. You know, you and I could sit back and do nothing. If you're saved, you could do nothing and just spend the rest of our lives and then die. And we would still end up here because salvation is that wonderful. But if we did that, we'd get to heaven and regret those choices. So how much better to be busy, to not pursue the things that waste time and that soak up resources, to not dwell on things that take away our peace and our joy, but to live purposefully, to be content, to be temperate, to represent the King, to minister to others' needs, to be focused, to trust the Lord, to preach this gospel of peace, and to come bringing our sheaves with us, as we saw on Wednesday. Let's be busy. Let's fulfill the Great Commission in the Lord's power, guided by Him, protected by Him, and bringing glory to Him. Let's pray. God, we thank You for the great mission that You've given us. And we don't understand why You would entrust it to us. You could do a much better job doing it yourself. We mess it up. We fumble our words and we forget things. But we do know, Lord, that when You use fallible humans to do a spiritual work, there is no glory that can be taken or claimed except by You. Only God could use sinners to do His work and do it well. And so, Lord, we thank You for stooping to use us that way. We thank You for the privilege of being involved in the Great Commission, and I pray that You would help us to be faithful in it. Help us to be joyful in it. Help us to be purposeful in it, to lay aside the weights and to be focused, to trust You, to be temperate and under control, to represent the King of Kings as You would have us to, and to be joyful and at rest, because it is a wonderful way to spend this earthly life. And one day we'll be carried up to glory and rejoice around the throne and thank the Lord at the privilege of being involved in saving sinners, bringing sinners to Christ. Lord, I pray that You would give us this burden. Give us this burning desire. Help us to pursue this with our life, to have this as our ambition, and to bring glory to Your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand together. Let's give ourselves to the Lord tonight. Let's surrender our lives. Let Him take control. Let Him use us. Let's let Him do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Only God knows how many sinners are out there that could be saved if God had full control of us. If God had full control of our finances, of our time, of our love, our desire, our pleasures, our appetites. What could God do if He had full control of all those things? As we are engaged in the Great Commission, let's remember the sorts of things that the Lord instructed His disciples to be engaged in. Song says, I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus? That's a penetrating question. Only You can answer that. Only the Lord can show you that. But may it be true of us. My best. I couldn't have done any more. I couldn't have given any more. I couldn't have desired, tried any harder. I couldn't have submitted any more, surrendered any more to God. I gave it all to him. The results are in God's hand. Only he can give the increase. But you can give him your life and see what he'll do with it. Would you turn in your hymnals to number 636? Let's prepare our hearts for Wednesday night. The missions conference is going to start. And maybe you already know some things that the Lord wants to do in your heart, but maybe you don't. Maybe the Lord is the only one that knows, but we can prepare our heart to receive those things. Let's sing a couple of verses of number 636. Burns.
Amen.